In this video, I want to describe the three circle framework, a useful tool for conceptualizing your competitive position in the marketplace and helping you to identify opportunities for growth. Three circle analysis was popularized by Urbany and Davis in their book, Growing by Focusing on What Matters, Competitive Strategy in Three Circles. Three circles refers to three stakeholders, the customer, the company, and the competitor. Specificity is paramount. Step one, identify the focal customer or customer segment. For the framework to be actionable, it needs to be a specific customer or customer segment. This is not a catch-all for all customers you could possibly serve. Next, are you conducting the analysis from the perspective of your firm, a business unit, or a product? Finally, identify the specific competitor. Avoid the temptation to use a composite or hypothetical best-in-class competitor on all dimensions. It needs to be a real competitor the focal customer could choose. Step two, list what the customer or customer segment values. The first circle contains the full list of customer needs as best you can determine them. Sometimes it can be helpful to annotate their relative importance. Step three, the second circle contains the full list of sources of value provided by your firm. Ideally, this is prepared independently from the list of customer needs in Circle 1. Bringing the customer and company circles together reveals three categories of value. The overlap is value created by your firm for its customers. It represents customer needs that are fulfilled by your firm. To the right are needs not currently met by your firm's offerings. To the left are aspects of the firm's offerings that are not valued by the customer. As you list out your sources of value, do not limit yourself to the feature or aspects of your product or service. It is best to write out what you're helping the customer accomplish. That is, why a feature might be important. Put yourself in the customer's shoes and answer, "I am so glad you provide feature because it lets me benefit." Step four, the third circle represents value created by the focal competitor. Again, it is important to use an actual alternative available to the customer and not some composite of competitors that, for example, may be the best in class on all attributes. The third circle contains a comprehensive list of what the competitor offers. The three overlapping circles create seven sections. Areas A and C are the points of difference or PODs. They are the classic competitive advantage areas. i.e., a firm offers unique value that matters to customers that its competitors does not or cannot offer. You will seek to build and defend area A, i.e., what is valued by the customer that is only available from you, and attenuate area C. Area B contains the points of parity or table stakes. These are must-haves that do not differentiate you from the focal competitor. Areas D, E, and F are offerings that the customer does not value or does not know about or understand. We'll call these unwanted or unrecognized value. A challenge when trying to complete these sections without engaging the customer as part of the process is that you often struggle to find anything that goes here. Put differently, there is typically a bias towards thinking that everything you do is appreciated by the customer, or else why would you be doing it? It is important to distinguish between two types of offerings captured here. The first we will call unwanted. These are classic overinvestments. You are providing things that the customer does not and will not value. Is there something here you can stop doing? These can be difficult to uncover without engaging the customer. If you approach it strictly from an internal-only perspective, it can be hard to say to yourself that you're doing things that are not creating value for the customer, or why else would you be doing them? The second are offerings you provide that the customer in theory should value, but does not because it is not salient or it is difficult to see the value. Can these be moved to a point of difference through some communication or education? Ask yourself, of all the sources of value you create, are you sure that they are salient to the focal customer and that the focal customer knows how to value them? Asking how the customer would feel if these items of unrecognized value went away, how would the customer feel or react? As an example of unwanted or unrecognized value, consider Apple Watch's time travel feature. It let users turn back or forward time to display certain information from a different date and time. Through integration with various apps, simply by rotating the digital crown, you can display the next morning's weather or your calendar without having to open a separate app. While developers seemed to like it, it never caught on with users and was eventually discontinued. Finally, area G is the white space, customer needs not being met by you or by the competitor. The white space consists of two types of needs. Unmet needs that are known are unmet for reasons that include your ability to satisfy them profitably. Unarticulated needs are needs customers do not readily mention or coherently express. It can be difficult to find anything that goes in the white space. Put differently, there is typically a bias towards thinking that you have a complete understanding of all the customer's needs and are taking actions to satisfy those needs. Consider the case of Attack, a laundry detergent introduced by the Kao Group in Japan in the 1980s. At the time, the customer needs for laundry detergent were well established. Cleaning efficacy, safe and gentle, good for the environment, ready to wear after drying, easy to use, and smells fresh and clean. These are the primary needs. To design new detergents, most manufacturers focused on some combination of these attributes. Also, some detergents were sold in large, high-value boxes to enhance perceived value. It turned out that there were several important secondary needs. Japanese consumers did not have the space to store laundry detergent in their apartments, and as a result, went to the store often. Consumers commonly went by bicycle or by foot, or by crowded subway. Kao recognized an unmet customer need and the corresponding attribute level, the need for a small package with the same cleaning power. Kao launched Attack, a highly concentrated detergent in an easy-to-use, easy-to-store package. Laundry customers were willing to pay a substantial price premium for this product, and within a year, despite the higher price, Attack commanded almost 50% of the Japanese laundry market. Other firms, including US-based firms, were slow to identify this customer need and did not immediately include the low package size attribute level in their marketing studies, which gave Kao a competitive advantage. Other examples of major innovations based on newly identified attributes and underlying customer needs include touchscreen features in the smartphone category and Procter & Gamble's Swiffer mop. Questions we often ask: how do we build and defend Area A, our points of difference? How do we eliminate or correct the unwanted or unrecognized value in Area E? Should we neutralize competitors' Area C, their PODs, and if so, how? How can we identify new growth areas in Area G? Is the focus unmet needs or unarticulated needs? Any framework that is a parsimonious description is trading off something. Three-circle analysis is silent on dynamics, so that must be considered separately. One way to do that is to consider table stakes and the deal clinchers today and 2 years into the future. What often happens when completing this 2x2 is that it makes salient that today's deal clinchers, i.e. the bottom left quadrant, are tomorrow's table stakes, i.e. the top right quadrant. Your job then is to identify what goes in the bottom right quadrant. What happens when a market commoditized? This is easily conveyed using a three-circle analysis. Area B, the points of parity, gets large as the customer needs are generally well known and largely met by each competitor's offerings. Unfortunately, an all too common pitfall when developing a value proposition is to be strictly internally focused, as Anderson and his co-authors observed back in the mid-2000s. They highlighted three perspectives firms take. Number one, shown in green, is the easiest path and almost always compiled by sitting at your desk. Unfortunately, this approach is too common in practice. Firms define their value proposition as the entire stack of benefits they provide without any consideration of customer needs or the competitor offerings. Number 2, shown in blue, defines the value proposition as all points of difference vis-a-vis the competition, i.e. wherever we are different adds value. Regrettably, this too is largely compiled from one's office desk. Number 3, shown in purple, requires getting out of the office to talk with customers. Its perspective is to identify the points of difference vis-a-vis the competitors that are actually valued by the customers, i.e. what resonates with customers. Three circle analysis checklist. Number 1, it is for a specific customer or customer segment and against a specific competitor. Number 2, prepare each circle independently. Number 3, it can be helpful to attach a measure of its relative importance to each attribute or feature. Number 4, it is okay to include value as a customer need or source of value, which could be manifested in something like a larger packet size. But avoid including price, which is a consequence of the value you create. Many struggle with what to do with price. Is price an antecedent or consequence of customer value? It is usually best to use the three circle analysis framework to help you understand the value or potential value you create first, then use that to help you arrive at a market-based price. This would suggest not including price in any of the sections, as price is a consequence of the value you create. Further reading. This concludes this video.